गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. वी कैन नॉट ऑलवेज बिल्ड द फ्यूचर फॉर आवर यूथ बट वी कैन बिल्ड आवर यूथ फॉर द फ्यूचर. यस. डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सोशल वर्क ऑर्गेनाइजेस सेमिनार्स एंड वर्कशॉप्स कंसिस्टेंटली फॉर स्टूडेंट्स टू गेन एन अंडरस्टैंडिंग द लाइफ चेंजिंग स्किल्स इम्प्रूव्ड कॉन्फिडेंस इफेक्टिव कम्युनिकेशन एंड लाइफ कोचिंग ड्यूरिंग दिस कोविड सीजन. The webinar is based on multi-stakeholders' participation. With the blessings of Almighty, my beloved teachers, I am pleased to deliver a warm welcome address. We are honored with the presence of dynamic personality, Reverend Father M. Eckermans Michael, Secretary of our college, who is responsible for all our achievements so far. I bow my head in gratitude to welcome you, Father.
Thank you. Thank you.
It's my gratitude to welcome the super hardworking person, Dr. A. Meenakshi Sundararajan. Your active life makes everyone feel at home in your company, hence ensuring and fostering the smooth running of the daily operations of our department. Please welcome on screen and join us, sir. A long-bending desire has been fulfilled today with the presence of Dr. Sigamani Panir Raman Fellow, Professor and Head, Department of Social Work, Central University of Tamil Nadu. He is one of the inspired personality in the field of research, coordinating activities, social work education, and publishing articles. He has been visiting research professor at various foreign universities. We are delighted and believe that your presence makes our participants to strengthen their skills in social work. On behalf of our department, I welcome you, sir. And above all, I would like to welcome faculty members from our college, other colleges, research scholars, our students and students from various colleges to this online webinar. It's my pleasure and honor at this juncture. I cordially welcome you all to this program. Thank you. Next, I invite Reverend Father Eckermans Michael to deliver presidential address at this moment.
The respected Principal Dr. Meenakshi Sundararajan, the respected Mrs. Mary Pelsit, the head of the Department of Social Work of our college, the respected Dr. Amalanathan, IQC coordinator, the respected faculties of computer science of our college, Mr. Thomas Robinson, Kenneth, Biju, and Ajil, and all my dear respected faculties from different colleges, very happy good morning to all of you. I am very happy to know that today the Department of MSW of our college is organizing a webinar on crisis management during the COVID-19 pandemic and beyond. And for this program, they have invited a guest speaker, Dr. Sigamani Panir. Sir, on behalf of the college, a hearty welcome to you. And thank you for having accepted this program. I really appreciate the Department of MSW of our college for taking various initiatives, and especially during this COVID, they're organizing this seminar on crisis management. And it is very much needed in this period. And my special appreciation to Mrs. Mary Pelsit. She is really working hard to bring out the department, to develop the department. After she took over the department as HOD, she is putting a lot of efforts and a lot of innovative and creative methods she is following. I know the faculties of MSW department are very, very happy with her. And the students also, they told me after Madam Pelsit Mary took up the HODship, the department is really growing and we also feel at home and we are very comfortable. So my special appreciation to Mrs. Felsit Mary, and my special appreciation to all the faculties of MSW also. And I'm very happy to inaugurate this program and make use of it. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you, Father, for your inspirational speech. Next, I would like to invite our principal to give an inaugural address of this program.
Good morning to each and everyone. Most respected secretary of our college, Reverend Father Eckermans Michael, HOD of MSW, Miss N. Mary Felsit, Dr. Punni, faculty members of Department of Computer Science, Mr. Thomas, Ms. Ajil, Mr. Kenneth, IQC coordinator of our college, Dr. Amalanathan, and PU. Dear participants, greetings from Nanjil Kathuli College for Arts and Science. I specially thanks to Dr. Sigamani Panniyar. When I contacted him over the phone regarding the webinar, in spite of his hectic schedule, he immediately obliged. I am willing to be the resource person, immediately informed to the HOD of MSW, Dr. Felsit. Immediately he accepted the offer, and the topic selected by the resource person, Sigamani, is very good topic. We are talking about the crisis management. Okay, we are already faced many problems like flood situations and other throughout the world. They find it very difficult to manage the COVID and its impact. COVID, its impact, it is not only how to manage the health. If the family is affected by the COVID, how good they manage the family? It is a crisis management. As a state government, find it difficult to control the COVID. How to allocate the people to work? How the doctors work? How they are managing it? Throughout India, the central government and state government is find it difficult to manage the situation of COVID and its impact, not only in the family, but on the economy, but on the higher education, all the education field, all the agriculture, whatever field, it is affected. So each and every individuals, whether you are rich or poor, COVID is severely affected by poor and rich. So inequality, there is no inequalities for COVID between poor and rich. So under these circumstances, the selection of topic is very important, very important. So how to manage? One is how to manage the family, how to manage the income and expenditure, the marginalized people are affected so much, how would they manage? Government is finding it difficult how to manage the financial economy, how to manage the healthy economy. In 2019, cholera was broke out. Crores and lakhs of people were died. COVID also is the same kind of disease. Now, the scientific is developing like this, but find it very difficult to invent a new medicine. Yesterday only Russia stated they invented a medicine. So crisis management is very important topic. I really congratulate Dr. Sigamani Panni, HOD of MSW, Tamil Nadu Central University. Sir, Swami sir, Valha, Valarha, Ninga Engalude phone la kooptu odane neenga accept panninga engude kalluriyin salvaga engude secretary in salva apre MSW salvaga engude manamarnda nandiye therivithukode vanakkam. Thank you one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you sir.
Thank you sir for your thought provoking talk. Next I hand over the session to our resource person, Dr. Sigamani Panniyar.
Good morning to all of you. Most Reverend Father Eggman Michael, Secretary, Nanjal Catholic College of Arts and Science. Respected Dr. Meenakshi Sundararajan, Principal. Dr. Mary Pelsit, Head Department of Social Work. Dr. Ponni, colleagues, friends, delegates. Good morning to all of you. Let me take this opportunity to thank the college principal, Dr. Meenakshi Sundararajan, for giving me this opportunity to share my views on the proposed topic. So before I start my presentation, I have a request for all the participants. May I request you to kindly mute your video and audio because it disturbs all of us. Please mute your audio and video. At the end of my talk, we will have question and answers. So today's presentation, the theme of my talk, it reads like this: multi-stakeholders participation in crisis management during the COVID-19 pandemic and beyond. This topic has four dimensions. The first dimension, it's about the conceptual framework of multi-stakeholder participation. The multi-stakeholder participation, again, it consists of several aspects like internal stakeholders and external stakeholders, multilateral stakeholders, bilateral stakeholders. Therefore, the first part of my presentation, we are going to contextualize the multi-stakeholders aspects. The second part, it deals with crisis management during the pandemic period, not just only the pandemic period, even beyond the pandemic period. So therefore, the theme of today's talk, has four dimensions: multi-stakeholders participation, crisis management during the COVID period and beyond the COVID period. Beyond the COVID period, it refers to disasters or any kind of pandemic situation across the globe. So this particular conceptual review or the perspective of my work, I would like to dedicate to helping professionals and victims of COVID-19. So today's talk has been divided into 12 subsections. So the first part deals with the scope of my talk. At the end of the 60 minutes of my talk, the learning outcome. So what are the things we are going to learn? Followed by introduction and data sources and limitations. So 99% of my presentation would be depends upon the available data source and also the case studies across the globe. Background and objectives, we do have few objectives for this particular paper. Taxonomy of COVID-19 and multi-stakeholders response. When you look at the taxonomy of this particular pandemic situation, we have like causes, consequences, and its implications. All levels, is there any need for multi-stakeholders response? Followed by multi-stakeholder participation, a conceptual framework. We're going to have the operational definition of multi-stakeholders participation, followed by emerging trends in multi-stakeholders participation, like during 90s, 20s, and right now, is there any paradigm shift in the framework of multi-stakeholders participation itself? Because in 1990s, the World Bank initiated this concept of multi-stakeholders participation in dealing with disasters. So is there any shift from that time to till date? That's what we are going to look at in that section, followed by. So lessons learned from various countries. So in the seventh section, again, we are going to have two subsections: lessons from developed countries, lessons from developing countries, that is emerging economies, and the role of partnerships. Followed by priority areas in multi-stakeholders participation, future research, policy relevance, summary, and conclusions. So this is what the structure of my talk. So throughout my talk, I'm going to refer seven keywords. That's the COVID-19, multi-stakeholder participation. See, the multi-stakeholder participation, public-private partnerships and joint venture are not the same. These are all different. Therefore, throughout my talk, I'm going to refer this particular terminology: networking, collaborations, global health governance, crisis management, multidimensional healthcare, civil society organizations. Now, 80s, 90s, and 2000s, this last three decades, we had several disasters. So disasters after disasters across the globe, people started posting this particular picture, like, you know, pray for Texas when there was a crisis in Texas. Similarly, when there was a crisis in Paris, similarly in Chennai, there was a flood. People started posting, you know, pray for Chennai. But right now across the globe, there's one slogan is going around: God, please help the world from all disasters, particularly the pandemic crisis. But now this conveys a message is that we, it's a time we all should work together. Look at this quote from the UN Secretary General, Special Representative of Disaster Risk Reduction. He says, if we do not lift our game, the COVID-19 pandemic will be viewed by our children as nothing but a warm-up act for the willful destruction of the planet. This is a time we must act as part of the prevention to save the lives. The take-home lesson of today's talk has eight major points. The first one, to understand COVID-19 pandemic and its impacts on health and development, we need to understand the direct and indirect linkages of these two aspects. To understand the dynamics and interconnectivity of health, society, economy, and development, and the role of stakeholders. Strategies for rebuilding economy, healthcare through multi-stakeholders participation. So therefore, this crisis witnessed that, you know, it's not just only a biomedical issue. This is related to societal development, economic development, women empowerment, and so on. Policy directions are decisions based on evidences to save lives, protect livelihoods, to learn multidimensional approach. Therefore, it's not just one approach is going to solve the problem. We need to have a multidimensional approach. Multi-diplomatic mechanisms. It's not just one country is going to deal with the issues. We need to have global governance participation in dealing with this crisis. To examine dimensions of multi-stakeholders participation in disaster management across the world, they have named this COVID pandemic as a disaster. In even India, we follow the disaster management protocols to prevent and control this pandemic crisis. So at the end, to document innovative collaborative strategic directions across the globe. Through this point, I'm going to bring out insights from 18 countries across the globe, 9 countries from development groups, 9 countries from developing countries group. Therefore, at the end of my talk, we all will realize, I'm sure, according to Henry Ford, he says, coming together is a beginning, keeping together is a progress, working together is a success. That's what the success mantra for preventing and controlling this pandemic crisis. So the contemporary society witnessed humanitarian crisis, including poverty, increased inequality, regional conflicts, civil wars, disasters, several disasters, global climate change, pandemic crisis, communal problems, growing inequality, etc. But we need a solution. I'm going to propose one alternative decision, alternative crisis management strategy could be the multi-stakeholders participation. To find alternative solutions that solves complex problems at the same time. The debate of sustainability development models. Of course, whether the sustainable development model is going to work or we need to reinvent any other alternative models. Holistic solutions to re-examine the networks of complex problems. Health and development threat around the world. As I said already, pandemic crisis, it is not just only a biomedical crisis. This is a crisis related to health and development. It is not just one country problem. It's a global problem. Lack of vulnerability analysis, global impact assessment to draw future directions. Why multi-stakeholders participation matters for international development. Impact of government relationship with civil society organizations. So the data sources for our talk today, so I referred data from more than 21 sources. The sources have been listed over here. Asian Development Bank, Bioscience, BMC, elsewhere journals, Open Access Journals, Future, Harvard School of Business. Like that, we have several other sources over here. So this work includes analysis of various factors. I could encounter four major limitations of this work. Number one, the limited availability of data. Since the multi-stakeholders participation, I was looking at the data related to country-specific data, for example, India-specific data. Who are the multi-stakeholders? At what level these people are involved? And what is it impacts on prevention of this particular pandemic? But due to the limited availability of data, I could not get the complete information. Lack of impact assessment studies across the globe. Limited empirical studies. So all these 21 sources, you know, most of them, more than 80% talks about invited papers or experts' views or perspectives, not on original empirical research papers. And also the last one, limited access to research. With the rapidly changing ecology, climate change, epidemic will become more frequent. That's what our history witnessed. Growing problems, pandemic, climate change of natural disaster and possibilities for evaluating and prescribing related policies is needed at this juncture. Uncertainty, complexity, new knowledge process. To integrate best available knowledge is needed at this juncture, reconcile values and preparedness. Global vulnerability to emerging and re-emerging threats to humans. Interlink between society, economy, environment, and development. Again, the available data witnessed that increasing attention to the need to strengthen the global capacity to prevent, detect, and respond to natural biological threats or the disasters. Look at this picture. 80s, 90s, and 20s, several problems has happened across the globe, like starting with the natural disasters in African countries, South American countries, welfare crisis again in African countries, natural disasters, oil crisis during 80s, democracy crisis during 90s, fall of Berlin Wall in Germany, dissolution of the Soviet Union during 90s, global financial crisis, and now the pandemic crisis. What is the solution? Look at this picture. This data shows that so far we had the three most devastating pandemics in the history, in the humankind. We had Black Death. It was started in 1347, ended in 1352. So much of deaths has happened. Followed by Spanish flu, the most devastating pandemic in the history of medical science. Started in 1918 and 1920, that was there for 2 years. And now the COVID crisis. Today, we had the case of more than 13 million cases across the globe, around 6 lakhs deaths, according to WHO. Therefore, this particular pandemic crisis witnessed that economic, social, and political change is needed at this juncture to bring change in the system. The COVID-19 pandemic is a challenge for all public systems, whether it's a global public system or national or state or regional, it's a challenge. Far-reaching consequences beyond the spread of COVID-19, national and international context with development, COVID-19 added to the existing problem, including communicable diseases, non-communicable diseases, inequality, gender issues, unemployment, starvation, below poverty line, etc. Now, almost every country is targeting only on the pandemic crisis. And what about the problem of communicable diseases, non-communicable diseases, all other issues? That's a big question mark. Health has become an area for diplomatic engagement. The best example is the COVID crisis. Better multi-stakeholder management can improve the effective and efficiency of crisis and humanitarian operations. That is one of the hypotheses of my talk. Developing competencies at all levels for emergency and crisis prevention and management. Therefore, no single agency can work alone to effectively control and mitigate its impact. Therefore, there's a need for multi-stakeholders participation. With that background, I developed four specific objectives for further exploring this particular issue. The first objective focuses on to understand the emerging and re-emerging COVID-19 pandemic crisis with the specific focus of health and development implications. Second, to explore crisis and country responses for solving wicked problems, like solving the unresolved problems through multi-stakeholders participation with the experience from across the globe. To understand and mapping the role of multi-stakeholders, including coordinating responses activities in time of crisis. To explore challenges and responses of multi-stakeholders participation. These are the specific objectives of my talk, my paper. Now, this COVID-19 crisis witnessed that huge economic loss, number of people affected are increasing over a period of time. It is unfolded. Right now, we don't know the exact number. And also, we don't know when it's going to end. Therefore, it's creating really a lot of problems. The taxonomy of COVID-19. Before December 2019, our life was altogether different. We were all together. We were all celebrating festivals. We were all together with our family, friends. But end of December 2019, the whole scenario has changed. The end of 2019, serious pneumonia cases of unknown cause emerged in Wuhan city in China. Mid of Jan 2020, deep sequencing analysis from lower respiratory tract samples identified a novel coronavirus as a causative agent for that pneumonic cluster. 11th February 2020, the WHO named the disease caused by the SARS-CoV-2 as COVID-19. This is also part of the SARS family. 11th March 2020, when the number of countries involved was 114 countries with more than 118,000 cases over 4,000 deaths. The WHO declared the pandemic status as the global crisis. Today, 14th July 2020, the COVID-19 is affecting more than 216 countries and territories around the world. I've reported a total of more than 13 million confirmed cases of the COVID-19 and a death toll of around 6 lakhs, nearing 6 lakhs deaths. The COVID-19 may present with mild, moderate, or severe. In severe cases, pneumonia, acute respiratory distress syndrome, sepsis, and septic shock can occur. That may lead to severe problem. Individuals 60 years and people with pre-existing comorbidities like cardiovascular diseases, lung diseases, or diabetics are the highest risk for developing serious complications. That's what the lessons from the globe. The incubation period of this new pathogen ranges from 1 to 14 days. That's the reason we are having 14 days of quarantine. And there is no pre-existing immunity to the disease. That means anybody can have this disease with symptoms or without symptoms or asymptomatic cases. Countries across the globe have adopted various prevention and control measures to minimize negative health impacts. But here's what we need, the multi-stakeholders participation. India has adapted various public health measures, which include social distancing measures, nationwide lockdown to reduce risk of exposure, widespread IEC, information, education, and communication messages regarding hand washing, usage of masks, and recommending avoidance of unnecessary travel to combat the spread of the disease. So there is a data from Spain. The end of social confinement and COVID-19 re-emerging risk. So they could not somehow control at the later point. They initially thought they have controlled it. But later this again came back due to lack of participation of people, lack of participation of multi-stakeholders. Another data from East Asia, governance, technology, and citizens' behavior in pandemic crisis. Lessons from Japan, China, India. In this work, they have highlighted the importance of self-discipline, role of governance and role of civil society organizations to control this particular pandemic crisis in East Asian countries. The basic concepts of countermeasures of COVID-19, another data, shows the future conditions. You know, if you are not involving everybody on board, it is going to create a major humanitarian crisis. So solving the humanitarian challenge is a top priority for all of us, whether it's an individual or family or a community or a state government or central government or a global governance or multi-stakeholders, all of us should be a top priority. Much remains to be done globally to respond and recover from counting the humanitarian cost of this, of the virus, to supporting the victims and families to develop a vaccine. This is what most important issues that we need to understand. There are two quotes, very interesting quotes. The COVID-19 pandemic is a public health emergency, but it is far more. It is an economic crisis, a social crisis, and human crisis that is fast becoming a human rights crisis, according to UN Secretary General. There's another quote. I think people haven't understood that this particular pandemic isn't about the next few weeks. This is about next at least 2 years, or even more than that. So this is today's data. Look at these top 10 countries. So throughout my talk, those multi-stakeholders participation, I'm going to refer the case experiences of all these 10 countries of multi-stakeholders participation. US, Brazil, India, Russia, Peru, Chile, Mexico, Spain, UK, and South Africa. These are the case I'm going to refer. How does this, how far this government is responding to prevent this particular pandemic crisis? The COVID-19 pandemic and the associated economic and social crisis are posing huge challenge. Availability of best accurate information, free affordable COVID-19 tests and treatments are not really available across the globe. The emerging issues related to jobs and income of millions of people, like a bunch of other issues it created. That means the lifelines in danger. One of the most serious problems the world faced in the recent times, the total cost is set to unfold. Restriction on economic activities, including production, distribution, and other services. High economic and social costs around the world. Changes in production and consumption pattern, crashing the markets and closure of business operations. Sending millions of workers back home may lead to labor crisis. Then the borders have been closed, value chain have been disturbed, travel, trade of institutions closed across the globe. More than 30 million people could fall into poverty in the absence of active policies. This will severely impact the health and well-being of large proportion of the population. So therefore, the COVID crisis had a major impact on health inequality, educational impact, gender issues, domestic violence, individual isolation, psychological impact, economic impact. Therefore, the COVID is unleashing a human development crisis, hitting hard on all human development constituent elements. These are the elements. Some more: political impact, environmental issues, person with special needs, including elderly issues, religious impact. Therefore, through the multi-stakeholders participation, we need to not just only to rebuild the economy, we need to rebuild the health system, we need to restructure the social system, we need to restructure the political system, vice versa. So what is that the multi-stakeholders participation means? There's a very interesting paper by Bickert on ownership dynamics in local multi-stakeholders initiatives. In this paper, this is key location for policy decisions making and action on global development issue. That's what the multi-stakeholders role. Distribution of commitment and responsibility across the stakeholders, bringing about collective actions and solutions for public benefit. Clear roles and responsibilities need to be brought out. Proactive prevention activities, community governance. There's another work by Kane. He says, stakeholders' participation among vested interest groups is often a core activity and seen as a major or less mainstream. The stakeholders involved may also belong to very different categories. For example, the generic public, those most affected by these decisions in their daily life, or those with the financial interest in the development. However, the multi-stakeholder participation in decision analysis tend to become quite complex, because we need to bring everyone on board, and the outcome can be both positive and negative. Multi-stakeholder collaboration could improve service delivery, international level participants, national level participants, local and regional level, community level participants. When we look at the theoretical framework of the multi-stakeholders participation, look at that 1920s to 70s, we had a traditional public management system, followed by 80s and 90s new public management. Later 90s, we had the networking governance model. Theoretically, the term multi-stakeholders participation has emerged from the discipline of political science, public administration, and business management. So 1920s, we had the traditional system. 80s, we had the new public management model. After 90s, we had the networking governance model. So over a period of time, the networking governance model led to the introduction of multi-stakeholders participation in policy formulation and development. Here, the UN organization, as well as the World Bank, played a major role in implementation of the multi-stakeholders participation in crisis management in African countries. Later, the particular model has been transferred to all over the world. So the myths and realities of multi-stakeholders participation. So initially, the World Bank had these two hypotheses. You know, it would be a coordinated effort and long-standing collaborations. Now also, for this pandemic crisis, we need to have a coordinated effort and long-standing collaborations to deal with all other associated crises. Therefore, multi-stakeholders participation, it is nothing but bringing everyone on board to deal with the common crisis. So this is beyond public-private partnerships model, as well as joint venture model. So interventions at community level and healthcare levels to ensure accountability and transparency. So therefore, the multi-stakeholders partnerships had the three-dimensional aspects, three pillars, to ensure accountability, transparency, and regulation. But the destructive factors are this. Number one, condition-based funding from multilateral agencies like WHO, World Bank, IMF, or even the condition-based funding from bilateral agencies like USAID, DFID, European Union, etc. That's one of the negative aspects of this particular model. Second, political stability or political instability. So sometimes, you know, all over the world, every political party is having their own agenda item to enforce the multi-stakeholders participation on crisis intervention. That's another negative factor. And again, vote bank politics. So the organizational structure of the Global Agenda for Sustainable Livestock. In this paper, there's a paper published in Springer Nature, Enhancing Food Security Through Multi-Stakeholders Process, the Global Agenda for Sustainable Livestock. In this particular framework, composed of stakeholders clusters, public sector stakeholders, private sector stakeholders, research institutions. Here again, we are talking about internal stakeholders, external stakeholders, national stakeholders, international stakeholders. They actually bring in this paper, they are actually arguing that, you know, like all of them should come together to work for a common cause with trust. So that one word, trust, will bring the success of this particular framework, the purpose, success of the multi-stakeholders participation. Look at this, some more clarification on the multi-stakeholders participation. So with the help of those 18 countries, I could draw about this particular framework. The multi-stakeholders participation includes international aid network, legislative and regulatory organizations like the governance, parliamentary system, logistics organizations, private sector, direct supplier of medical equipments or even other equipments, media, local aid network, military, paramilitary forces, government, international organizations, donor agencies, international organizations, again classified into two categories, bilateral organizations and multilateral organizations. So some more classifications: international health regulators, international institutions, multi-stakeholders initiatives, regional organizations, emergence of WHO summit. So these are all the various organizations. Therefore, the examples of stakeholders in a clinical research setting, another paper published by Kandi and Perumal. There's an excellent paper published in Frontiers in Psychiatry. They're again classifying the list of external stakeholders, internal stakeholders, and their roles and responsibilities. What they say is at the end, it's the right time we should have a potential partnerships models to deal with the crisis. So the emerging trends in multi-stakeholders participation, the global preparedness, contingency planning, that is what the major emerging areas in the multi-stakeholders participation, lack of post-crisis reconstruction and recovery, weak legal and institutional mechanisms, weak infrastructural facilities, including communication network, lack of systematic and periodic assessment, lack of accounting of potential losses, poorly managed financial, technical, and human resources. Through the multi-stakeholders participation, we may manage it efficiently. Spontaneous behavioral reactions, like there is a generalized panic situation. Maybe through the partnerships model, we can work out the panic situation. Rumors regarding the spread of the epidemic, exposure to elements like living conditions, food and nutrition issues, the risk of epidemic, infectious diseases after a crisis is related to the endemic level of virus. For example, vaccination, rehabilitation, water supply, food safety, basic sanitation and personal hygiene, other zoonotic diseases. Because now all over the world, the fear here again, we may have another problem, maybe another virus, investment in research and development. So the crisis taught us a lesson. You know, it can lead to a national emergency if you're not solving right now. Need for dedicated funding for staffing, equipments and resources, appropriation to support state, local and other health departments. The need for preparedness effort to protect people and support communities. Need for early public health countermeasures and mitigation. Ensuring the health and safety of population. Linkages among all levels of states and non-state actors. Again, in the multi-stakeholders participation, the role of state and non-state actors is indeed needed. Broadening community and stakeholders engagement, enabling care for patients. So the multi-stakeholders participation across the globe, cases from Taiwan have witnessed networking, proactive testing, border control, transparency was a major initiative. The crisis management strategy was frequent health checkups, public education, relief to business. The partners are multi-layer governance at all levels, private organizations, insurance companies. South Korea was referred as one of the good model during this crisis period. They've introduced timely emergency response, nationwide network of networking or networking among stakeholders, shared interest, priority-based emergency response, rapid response. They also had government, community, and civil society organizations. China and Singapore, similarly, the collaboration of science, including social sciences. So they used large-scale coordination, institutional timely response for crisis management. Again, they had partners like government, industry, banks, financial institutions, community resilience. Malaysia, they had a major approach was movement control order, where they used crisis management strategies that produce more PPE equipments, like personal protective equipments for the medical professionals, fundraising, collaborations with healthcare service providers, including additional laboratories. Malaysia and New Zealand had almost a similar model. Government, civil society organizations, and communities are the various stakeholders. In India, one of the major approach was the lockdown. Lockdown, again, the crisis management strategy was emergency management, but only few places we followed. You know, there was policies, but somehow the stakeholders were not in a position to strictly implement the emergency management models. Interstate transmission control, the government introduced multi-layer governments like government of India, state governments, district level, local level, private and civil society organizations. Italy, they used one of the major approach as pandemic management approach. The crisis management strategies were institutional arrangements, again, governments and civil society organizations. Broaden for more case studies across the globe. industrialized economies, as I said already, there's some problem with the numbers. So 9 countries, Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, New Zealand, Sweden, United Kingdom, and United States. So they were using, you know, well-functioning federalism and then interlinkages between systems to system. So one of the major, the strategy, crisis management is management strategy they have implemented is that the trustworthiness between the layers of government, like, for example, Canada, well-functioning federalism to ensure long-term care, France, closure of non-essential non-essential public places and services, Germany also referred as one of the successful model, developed a reliable test, Italy institutional arrangements, and Italy actually they have initially undermined the virus, that's the reason they had a major problem. But now same may be replicated in our country also, like cities like Delhi, Chennai, Mumbai. Japan, effective implementing of self-discipline. Now also they are very strict, they follow strictly. New Zealand, one of the successful model of this pandemic crisis management. Lockdown measures, safeguarding healthcare professionals. Sweden, again they have undermined the coordinated national action. That's the reason they had huge cases. United Kingdom, research mitigation, US. US again was referred as one of the ineffective response to the COVID crisis. So these are all the observations from those sources. Look at the bottom line, sources developed from various sources. Emerging economies, rapidly emerging markets, China, Hong Kong, India, Indonesia, Israel, Malaysia, Singapore, South Korea, Turkey. So again, there is another problem all over rapidly emerging markets again witnessed that there is a need for multi-stakeholders participation in crisis management. So one of the critical problem here, the second wave of re-emerging COVID-19, again, the new cases are coming up in New Zealand, Australia, Italy, South Korea, China, and most important, India, Kerala. Again, the Kerala cases are again coming up. Now, the policy recommendations from 190 countries, there's another evidence from this many sources. There are 21 set of crisis management strategies through the multi-stakeholders participation. External travel restrictions we need to still enforce. Health facilities we need to strengthen. Quarantine, tracking and testing and retesting, advisory system, public awareness. Non-essential businesses need to be closed down. Government services to be ensured. Mass gathering to be prevented. School and universities continue to be closed. Curfew need to be strengthened. Health data management or epidemiological data management. State of emergency. Internal travel restrictions. Lockdown policy. Decentralized communication. Proactive with community. Clear coordination role. So these are all the crisis management strategies from 190 countries. The sources have been highlighted here. Therefore, at the end, the connecting with stakeholders, establishing mutual trust between the national level, international level, local level, regional level partners to be part of the crisis. Look at this picture. This is all based on Indian experience. Our fight against the rapidly evolving COVID-19 has 13 major aspects. Extensive testing is needed. For that, we need participation from private NGOs, civil society organizations, contract tracing, community mobilizations, crisis precautions, cluster containment strategy, public health surveillance, proactive state leadership, knowledge of the particular pandemic, expected and unexpected things we'll have to prepare, awareness, service orientation, supply chain information. Further, some more evidences from those countries have been already highlighted. I don't want to repeat, but still I'd like to highlight few more points related to the crisis management during this pandemic situation. We need to strengthen the crisis management and response strategies to recognize your cognitive biases. Every state must understand and realize and recognize their strengths and weaknesses. Avoid partial solutions to deal with the crisis situation. Learning is critical. We must learn from the best practices. For example, we must learn lessons from South Korea, Japan, New Zealand, Australia. Extensive testing of symptomatic or asymptomatic cases early on. Like for example, South Korean case, proactive tracking of potential positives, for example, New Zealand case, a strong emphasis on home diagnosis and care. Indeed, in India, this is what is needed right now due to the limited availability of healthcare facilities. Specific efforts to monitor and protect healthcare and other healthcare workers, and then the farmers, other bunch of stakeholders. Therefore, at the right time, we must have stakeholders' participation in dealing with the crisis situation. So the priority areas, again, as I said, the economic, social aspects, and then mental health issues. Therefore, one of the emerging priority areas are this. Beyond COVID-19 for international development, this particular crisis has witnessed that there is a need to identify innovative and culturally acceptable measures to prevent such kind of crisis, to identify easily available, culturally adaptable local technology, which is easily accessible and affordable to everyone, ensuring that the most vulnerable populations are getting the benefits, and to address the immediate and long-term impact of this particular pandemic. Involving communities to ensure that essentials, including alternative livelihood opportunities, advocating priority-based social welfare policies for the vulnerable population, facilitating easily acceptable physical distancing with social solidarity. Again, some more observations. Advocating for the advancement and strengthening of social welfare services as an essential protection against the disaster. Identify easily adaptable or doable strategies to deal with the situation, and then we need to strengthen the research base. To develop capabilities at all levels, national, state, and local levels, reactive state leadership, for example, Germany leadership model, New Zealand leadership model, Japanese leadership model, mobilizing women's leadership like Germany and New Zealand, participation and accountability to strengthen inter-organizational coordination, local responsibility with centers coordination. Therefore, the entire available data shows that need huge dedicated funding to deal with the emerging and re-emerging infectious diseases condition. This particular pandemic is a wake-up call. A joint panel report by Harvard School of Public Health and London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, they says the accountability with clear leadership role is a must for dealing with the crisis situation, which include access to vaccine, incentives for early reporting, failure to prevent antimicrobial resistance, mitigation of health workers from developed countries, the destruction of in the social the understanding the relevance of social determinants of health. And again, another study by Madhyasan says the coordinated effort in preparedness of and response to public health emergencies. The public health emergency includes risk assessment, prevention and mitigation, incidence management, resource management, communications, operations and training, exercising evaluation, continuous quality improvement. Therefore, there is a need for innovative, cost-effective healthcare service delivery models, like we had already witnessed with HIV programs, Ebola 1 and AMR 1, that multi-stakeholders participation really, really worked well. That was ensuring the cost-effective healthcare service models. Therefore, based on those available cases and case evidences, I would like to draw your attention for the scope for future research in this area to understand the COVID-19 entire crisis cycle, causes and consequences, recovery, mitigation, response, and preparedness, revisiting data set, redefining relevant methodologies, facilitating access to online resources, and exploring culturally relevant approach, search for relevant information resources, and try to compile proper data of active, closed cases of their cases and their relatives, global monitoring framework, and the sustainable development goals. We need to further explore the COVID-19 its impact on social development, human happiness, and well-being of people, professionals working in this area, synthesis evidences rapidly, and to provide massive interventions, guidelines, and longer-term strategies for human happiness and well-being. Ensuring adequate quality of your work and communicate the same with multi-stakeholders, including policy briefs. To strengthen community-based risk crisis risk management, we need more research replicate the best practices. We need to document those best practices. The way I already highlighted those case studies from across the globe, we need to document more evidences. Learn from the field. So now the policy relevance. According to Harvard School of Kennedy School of Governance proposed few recommendations for developing or improving the multi-stakeholders participation. So one of the critical areas is the provision of credible communication to the public without politicizing the message, like provision of reliable information. Drawing together, that means the working together, is one of the major strategy for the multi-stakeholders participation. The public sector must lead the whole society during this crisis. Government need to focus on providing authoritative information via multiple sources to ensure accurate data, to slow the spread of the that we don't trust our health system all at all once. Increasing transparency is needed across the partners to recognize the potential for psychological burnout. Again, the therapeutic medical interventions for this particular crisis. Government need to strike a balance between protecting health and respecting human rights, new priorities and network national spending priorities. The government should address the long-standing challenges of health and nutrition issues, creating a synergy between partners, one of the critical area to understand, collaborating to identify and engage strong partners. Therefore, the most effective intervention strategies, including creating of effective mechanisms to enable international, national, and regional organizations to establish pathways through which multiple actors can work together, power and legitimacy with global health. Therefore, one of the most important strategies was developing a synergy between society, economy, and development. Therefore, there's a need for strong global health governance. Look at the crisis, one of the major crises, the economic crisis. So the data from World IMF and World Bank, they say, across the globe, we are witnessing 3%, negative 3% GDP, and cumulative output loss could be maybe around $9 trillion. The second critical area, community and clinical and community-based research, we really need. For that, we need multiple stakeholders' participation, including colleges, institutions, universities across the globe. So understanding of pandemic risks in all its dimensions, interlinking of disaster management and development planning. Another one is a multi-sector approach for holistic development. Holistic and integrated healthcare system and infrastructure is needed. The next one is the relevance of healthcare data management for evidence-based policy. We need to generate reliable data on the epidemic crisis, epidemiological information to guide policy making and implementation. Felt need assessment and the community empowerment is another critical area for the multi-stakeholders participation. Integrate alternative livelihood models, enhancing programs, ensuring the universal health coverage. Active and effective legal framework and another area requires greater engagement of all parties. And they should follow the legal enforcement system. Regulatory and institutional responses is needed. Public accountability crisis and social responsibility. That's a new form of multi-layer governance for global health, especially the during and after the pandemic crisis. So the last one is the self-discipline. Again, I'm always referring three-country model, Japanese model, South Korean model, German model, New Zealand model for the effective management of multi-stakeholders participation during the crisis situation. To build partnerships with nations through developing the trust. So early and rapid detection and diagnosis of infection is needed at this juncture, especially in India, to develop capabilities at all levels for emergency and pandemic prevention and management. Reactive state leadership, mobilizing women's leadership, participation and accountability to strengthen inter-organizational coordination, local responsibility with the center's coordination. To sum up whatever we have discussed so far, to strengthen the public health surveillance and preparedness for pandemic management through research, capacity building and action, collaborating with institutions to provide support in surveillance preparedness and capacity building during the public health emergencies, development and delivery of training courses, strengthening sustainable development institutional mechanisms to control virus transmission risk factors, inter-regional and national public health and emergency management, multi-stakeholders participation in access to medicine, essential medicine, resource sharing and investment in research and development. To conclude, to sum up, again, as I said already, you know, this particular pandemic crisis had an impact on all dimensions, economic, social, and like geographical, and then other aspects, like loss of lives, injuries, economic loss, huge infrastructure like that. Therefore, there's a need for effective strategy and effective mechanisms to enable international organizations to deal with the crisis. Long-term and social and economic consequences need to be examined. So how to get the economy back on track? So where to start? There's a problem across all system, all levels. Once a strategy could be fixing our economy, rising unemployment, bank in crisis, healthcare crisis, falling GDP, food supply, social safety net, and farmers unrest, public investment, priority-based policy. Therefore, the one start point could be restructuring our economy so that we'll provide employment opportunities, livelihood opportunities. So therefore, to conclude, I would like to again conclude my talk with 10 major observations. The first one, extensive and systematic assessment is needed at this juncture with the help of multiple partners, connecting with all stakeholders as individuals and establishing mutual trust, distributing leadership responsibilities, communicating with clarity and regularity, implement pragmatic and innovative approaches to deal with pandemic management across the globe, develop strong linkages between strategic partners, develop alternative resource mapping strategies, strong institutional and legal framework is needed, promote inclusive community-based approach to deal with this crisis. Innovative approaches, for example, virtual care, home-based care need to be introduced. Learning from prior experience or learning from the best practices at the end, political will and efficient leadership is needed at this juncture to deal with the crisis. So all problems lies with the political willingness as well as the efficient leadership role. That's what we have witnessed with Japanese model, South Korean model, New Zealand model, Australian model, even in Kerala model. Therefore, the potential public health disasters, you know, there's a quote I would like to refer. The earth, the air, and the land, the water are not an inherent from our forefathers, but on loan from our children. So we have to hand over to them, at least as it was handed over to us. That's one of the success mantra for the crisis management at this juncture. So therefore, we need to enhance self-responsibility. Please stay at home. Don't go out. Pandemic is a global crisis, but the response needed at local level, every individual level. So we'll have to follow the protocol by WHO and the government. Stay safe, healthy, connected, and keep learning. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir, for your informative, intellectual input and systematic presentation. Thank you so much, sir.
Ma'am, I have something to say. Sorry, ma'am, due to time constraint, I need to like run through it. So it's about 180 country experiences. I thought of bringing out that experience. Maybe subject to the availability of time, we can take more questions so that I will explain some more or I will give more examples.
Okay. Participants, if you have doubt, please ask or type it in the chat box.
Sir, you spoke about the multi-stakeholders involvement, and I want to know how India is backward in the stakeholder presentation. You told that India is following only the lockdown thing, and it is not following the other strategies like other countries. And now I want to know whether how India can cope up with more strategies in the multi-stakeholders involvement.
That's great. That's a great question. So let me give you an example from New Delhi, New Delhi, Mumbai and Chennai. New Delhi, they are doing a good job. So they are trying to integrate even a smaller private clinics, laboratories, other institutions for quarantine and treatment and testing. So this is a high time we must recognize the other stakeholders' potential, including the private service providers, NGOs, civil society organizations, even the individuals and communities. Slowly, slowly, now the Delhi government is trying to do, and also Indian government, they're trying to request, they have already requested the state governments to identify the locally available resources, including the partners for effective pandemic crisis management. But we need to really follow strict systemic model, like what the New Zealand has done, what Germany has done, even what the South Korea has done. We'll have to implement. Now, it's not the problem in the urban areas. Now, the problem in the rural areas. Therefore, it's a high time the government, state government, central government, even the local government, of course, they are doing their best, but still they will have to go beyond what they are doing right now. They will have to recognize the potential available at the local level, especially for the crisis management. Like number one, testing, isolating, contract tracing, and rehabilitating and provision of mental health services. For that, only state can't do everything. So they will have to identify the other service providers.
Any other questions? Dear participants? Sir, many of the participants asking your mail ID and share your PPT.
My mail ID is here, ma'am. I... 1 minute.
Yes. Can you give it in the chat box?
This is my mail ID, ma'am. It's there in my... Yeah, we'll do that.
Sir, I have another question. I think it's useful to others. The question is the role of social workers in this pandemic crisis. What is the role of our profession?
Wow. That's a very good question, but for that we need another session. Number one. So multi-stakeholders, one of the major stakeholders are social work professionals. Provision of mental health services, support system, crisis management, technical support, extending research-based knowledge, developing a lot of, case studies. Research and advocacy is a major... I think many of our participants are asking my PPT. So at this juncture, I'm sorry, I'm not going to share my PPT because this is a research paper. I may share my published paper soon. But this is, at this juncture, I'm sorry, I'm not going to share my PPT. If you have any specific requirements, please write to me. I will share the published papers. Sam?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Is there any other question I can take? There is another question in the chat box. Let me read out that question for others. After witnessing an extensive review of literature done by you, I would like to know whether you have found the tool for data collection to understand the particular phenomenon. So far, no, but still we can work out the tool. One of the major role of the social work profession. We can develop tool based on your area of research interest on this particular pandemic.
Dear participants, any other questions? Sir, want to conclude anything?
Yes, ma'am. At the last point, I would like to highlight, self-discipline. Please follow self-discipline norms. Don't go out. Follow the protocols. Insist your family members, friends, others to follow the same. That's the only way we can break the chain of infection. So as I said earlier, this particular pandemic this is an altogether different kind of pandemic. So it has a major impact on everything. Therefore, the starting point, self-discipline, that's the only way we can break the chain of infection.
That is true, sir. Thank you, sir. Next, I invite Dr. S. Ponni to propose vote of thanks.
Hello, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes. Yes, ma'am. You continue.
Good morning to all. Respected dignitaries, it is my privilege to give vote of thanks on this occasion. I place on record my sincere gratitude to our Secretary, Reverend Father M. Eckermans Michael, and our Principal, Dr. A. Meenakshi Sundar Rajan, for the tremendous support for our department growth. We are thankful to the resource person, Dr. Sigamani Panneer, Professor and Head, Central University of Tamil Nadu, for delivering such a wonderful lecture during this period. Then I thank Thomas Sir for assisting technical service for the successful of this webinar. Then I thank our department staff, Krishna Prasad Sir, and especially HOD ma'am, and all the participants for the successful of the webinar. Thank you. Thank you so much for one and all. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Shall we wind up?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.